Ancient Chinese civilization was formed in between the Hung He and the Yangtze River, shortly after other river civilizations. So this is the fourth major river valley civilization. You have Mesopotamia, Egypt, Indus River Valley, and the fourth one is China. You could argue that China is the oldest living civilization on Earth because it's been there for 4,000 years. That's not an exaggeration. There has been a China there for 4,000 years. Ancient Egypt, not a thing anymore. It's a whole different culture. Ancient Mesopotamia, not a thing anymore. Indus River, we can't even read their language. China's still there. The river is very unpredictable and chaotic, probably worse than Mesopotamia. Oftentimes the flooding in China is called China's sorrow because of how devastating flooding has been in China throughout history. The first dynasty, which probably wasn't even real, the Xia dynasty. So according to legend, the Xia was China's first dynasty led by Emperor Yu, who brought flood control and irrigation to the civilization. This probably isn't a real story. It's probably just a legend how China was able to advance at such an early age because of irrigation. It's easier to tell little kids that a guy named Yu developed irrigation instead of saying, well, over the course of time, it slowly became a thing. That's way more boring. It's way cooler to develop a mythical father of the country. The Shang dynasty was the first documented ruling family. So the Shang was for sure a real thing. The Shang established the Chinese tradition of government, including a hereditary monarch and a complex bureaucracy. Hereditary monarch just means that the crown stayed in the family. One of the descendants of the king will be the next king or queen. During this time, China developed a writing system, complex urban planning, as well as irrigation practices. The Zhou dynasty began to rule China around 3,000 years ago. So the principle of the mandate of heaven emerges under the Zhou. I don't know why, but every class I've ever seen over ancient China ask about the mandate of heaven. So the mandate of heaven is the idea that the ruler is in charge, and if everything's going good, if everything's good in the kingdom, he's doing a good job, he has the mandate of heaven. On the flip side, if things start to go bad, if there's like famine or war or awful things going on, that means the ruler has lost the mandate of heaven. And it can be a justification for another family to overthrow that dynasty and to take power. Now, let's rewind for a second. The Zhou justified overthrowing the Shang because they said, oh, but before that, there was the Xia dynasty that probably didn't exist. Like the Zhou literally made up the mandate of heaven in order to justify their rule. Unlike Mesopotamia and Egypt, the Chinese emperors didn't claim to be gods themselves. In Egypt and Mesopotamia, those rulers claimed to literally be gods on earth. It's a little different because in China, they were saying, no, we have the authority from heaven or just, you know, divine power to be in charge. It's a much different concept. So as the dynasty declined, the feudal system, remember the feudal system is where the emperor doesn't really have that much control and he has other people ruling little sections of the kingdom that just pay him money, that's it. By 480, China descended into what we call the Warring States period, which is a very defining period for how China will develop. Major Chinese philosophies will emerge during this time. Taoism, sometimes it's spelled with a T or a D, same thing. Taoism was founded by Lao Tzu in China. During the Warring States period, this philosopher stressed living a simple life in harmony with nature and the natural order over the social order of mankind. Taoism is based on an idea of a universal force called Tao, or the way that guides all things. This philosophy is where the yin-yang symbol comes from. The yin-yang symbol has the same amount of white as black, and it represents the balance that nature has to have. So Confucius lived in China during the Warring States period, just like Lao Tzu. He argued that the established tradition of filial piety and the mandate of heaven held the key to social order. Essentially, he argued family served as a model for society as a whole. The way I like to put it is, Confucius said, everybody takes care of their moral role in their individual relationships and in their family relationships, society as a whole will be better. He compared the relationship between the emperor and their subjects to the relationship between a father and a son, or an older brother and a younger brother. He said, the person who's subservient has to be respectful and obey the superior, but the superior also has a duty to be benevolent and to be just whenever they are in this relationship. Also, Confucius is where the golden rule comes from, never do to others what you would not like done to you. Pretty good rule to live by. Also, the Analects laid out the five relationships. The Analects are a book or a collection of writings from Confucius that outlines the philosophy. It's the closest thing to a Bible-type text I can give for Confucianism. Legalism. This one's fun. Legalism is another philosophy that emerged in ancient China during the Warring States period. Proponents of legalism argue that humans were naturally self-serving and destructive. Therefore, social order had to be maintained by strict laws and harsh punishments. That's how you keep society together. All three of these philosophies, plus Buddhism, kind of merged together for the overall belief system in China. The Qin Dynasty. Xu Huangdi emerges as the emperor of China, ruling the Qin Dynasty. The Qin built a highly centralized bureaucracy with legalism as its governing philosophy. So remember, legalism is very harsh punishments, very harsh and strict rule. The Qin unified China politically, economically, and culturally. It completely got rid of the old feudal system the Zhou used. In fact, Qi Huangdi made every family live in the capital with him so they couldn't prepare a rebellion in their own part of the kingdom. Also, the word China in English comes from the word Qin. So the Qin Dynasty actually doesn't rule for that long. It's only around for 21 years. But it's very, very impactful because they're the first dynasty to centralize China and to break the old feudal system that the Zhou was in. You see the map. It's not entirely all of modern China, but it's definitely got the Huanghe and the Yangtze River valleys. You can also see where the Great Wall is starting to be built. Originally, all those walls separated all the different kingdoms during the Warring States period, and a lot of walls were just kind of added onto to create that northern boundary. The Qin standardized weights, coinage, laws, riding, even how big your axle had to be for your wagon on the road was standardized by the Qin. There's things that weren't that standard in Europe 100 years ago that were standardized in China at the time. The state directed the construction of an extensive road and a canal system that connected both rivers via canal, which was a humongous achievement in engineering in the ancient world. By 210, Xu Huangdi dies, and this plunged China into absolute chaos. Also, he probably died from drinking mercury, thinking it would make him immortal. He really was insane. If you're ever bored, look into some of the antics of Xu Huangdi. It's nuts. The Qin fall after a short but very effective rule that helps set the stage for the next dynasty that will rule for 400 years. Again, the Qin don't rule for very long, but it's very important for how China will develop. 210, after Xu Huangdi dies, and as the Qin collapses, a peasant named Li Bang emerges as the new emperor. So the name China in English comes from Qin, but the ethnic group in China that rules China is called the Han people. It's the largest ethnic group in the world with almost a billion people. And not everybody in China is Han, by the way. There's multiple ethnic groups. So the Han dynasty maintained many of the policies of the Qin, but tampered the severity of legalism and merged more Confucian belief into the way they governed. So Emperor Wudi made Confucianism the official state religion of China. He expanded the empire, and he greatly increased Han influence abroad. Wudi believed the government could earn the respect of people, which was like the complete opposite of Xu Huangdi and the Qin dynasty. The Han dynasty, I argue, was the strongest empire on the planet. And this was while Rome was standing. And I have colleagues that'll fight me over that. But I maintain, like, this is the strongest state to exist from here until about 1700. So a lot of people freak out and they're like, oh no, China's gonna be the most powerful country for the first time ever. And people like me are like, don't say that. It's actually kind of rare recently how China has not been the superpower of the world. China was so prosperous back then that they wouldn't trade with other kingdoms unless their leader bowed to the emperor 12 times in public in like a ceremony called a kowtow, because the Chinese said they had no need to trade with anybody else because they were that rich and that resource rich. It really is incredible how well off China was during this time period. And you see how extensive Han Dynasty spread. This is the beginning of China stretching all the way into Central Asia. The Han government was staffed by an educated civil service who were selected using a rigorous civil service examination, which assessed their Confucian knowledge. Essentially, they had to take a test over Confucianism to see if they were eligible to be a government official. In China, one of the coolest things you could do, one of the most prestigious things you could do, was be a government official, which is like the opposite of our society. It really was renowned to be a government official, and you had to have the Confucian philosophy to do it. Now, in theory, anybody could take these exams, but in practice, you had to be wealthy to afford the tutoring to prepare for these exams. Some historians argue this is the first use of an exam in history, really, in the way you think of exams where you sit down and take a test. Now, note, 200 CE, remember, this starts in 200 BCE, the Han Dynasty finally falls. Once the Han has their rule, like the way China works is established. There will be a series of dynasties from then until 1911. My great-grandfather was alive. This system will stay the way that it was here for another 2,000 years. And it's the same system where one dynasty comes into power, rules for a while. Once bad things start to happen, another dynasty overthrows them, claiming they now have the mandate of heaven. It's the same system. In fact, we call this the dynastic cycle. Silk Road, the open land of Central Asia had numerous nomadic societies. These societies were experts in the use of pack animals, such as horses, camels, ox, all kinds of various animals. Transportation technology improved over time. But what I'm getting at is, on the Silk Road, it wasn't like Chinese merchants would travel all the way to Europe trading goods. They would trade with somebody in Central Asia. Then the Central Asia horse people would trade with somebody in the Middle East. Somebody in the Middle East would trade with somebody in Europe. And the next thing you know, Chinese silk is in Rome. That's how the Silk Road worked. It wasn't like one person would travel all the way across. In fact, that's extremely rare. The first European that we have record of traveling to China won't happen until the 1200s CE. It's like a mythical land. Like the Han and Rome were aware of each other, but it was like they only knew about each other through intermediaries. The Indian Ocean Network I mentioned earlier is remarkable because it was one of the only ocean networks, really. Most trade was done over land during this time period. Later on in this class, we'll talk about the trade networks in Africa over land. And land trade will be the most profitable until around Columbus's time. That's whenever it really becomes easier to do it by ship.